Hello, I'm Cara Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's a bench.
And here's me. There's not always a bench. That's a metaphor.
Here we go.
That's stupid. This is kind of fun.
Well, you know, what you do here is the reason why I'm playing organ.
Let's start. Because, okay. I mean, what I want this to be like is exactly as we're talking now. Okay. It's just fun.
You did a fabulous concert.
Oh.
But you know that, right?
Well, I had a lot of fun.
You had a lot of fun.
And I got to go up there
playing.
You
played really well. But you know you connected, didn't you?
Well, I think so, because what I love about playing, and one of the reasons why I love playing here, is because the audience is so nice, but they're also so open.
Yes.
Where in the world can you go in a summer park, first of all, with an organ?
No, no.
That's kind of obvious. In a summer park and play a great Liszt masterwork that pianists don't know of.
Yeah, I know.
And then a crowd of I just heard it was 2875.
Yes.
The official count was, really loves that piece.
Yeah. It's amazing. But it's how you play it, though, right? I mean, if somebody else came on and played the same piece but did it in a really dead, boring way, you'd probably be you and just a couple of us playing stage.
Yeah. Well, Liszt takes a lot of... Liszt and Reger, that I started with. I love that music so much because there's so much to it.
Yeah.
And in a bar of Liszt, especially in the odd notes, sometimes there's two notes, or there's a trill or something. But that means so much in the music, and if it was any other kind of trill, if the trill was one extra beat, the piece wouldn't stand on its own.
Yeah.
It's so stunning, and then you get to delve into that music.
Yes.
And people, some people ask me at USC, well, what do you do in your spare time? Well, I keep practicing.
So you're saying that it was this instrument that got you into the organ?
Yeah.
Really?
Well, so I came here, Well, so here's the story. We went to France to visit families. You know, I'm French, and back then I played...
And what part of France?
I'm from Lyon.
Right.
And at that point in time, my mom's side of the family is from Lille, the north of France, and dad's side is from Grenoble, the Alps.
Nice.
All those places around the southern Alps. Gorgeous, gorgeous over there. And so we were visiting Paris, my first time in Paris. And so, of all places, we go to Notre Dame, and I think back then I did not play organ. So I played electric guitar, will you believe it? I played 7 years of classical and electric. And so zoom back about 8 years from today, and I was probably jamming to Eddie Van Halen and to all those people, who are still an influence. I think when I play Liszt, that side of Eddie Van Halen, I mean, harmonic minor scales up and down as fast as you can.
Yeah.
With the hair down to here, I mean, Liszt came up with it. And that's true. And so I see this organ, I didn't think much about it. I thought, well, that's a pipe organ, that's pretty cool. And so then I looked it up on the way, when we came home, and I found Louis Vian playing Bach. Mm-hmm. I thought, wow, that's amazing. And then I looked it up, and we have this huge organ here. So I thought, well, that's cool. So I convinced my dad to drive me down from Encinitas to Arbor Park. And you were playing, and you played some Carl Jenkins, and you played the Tournemire Te Deum. And I was blown away by that concert, and so then I thought, this is great, and I can compose for it, but I need organ lessons after that concert that you played, so thank you.
That's very moving.
I might not have gotten organ lessons. I might have written an organ piece and thought, well, okay, now it's some more.
It's amazing what gets you to that point where you know what you want to do.
Yeah.
It is. It's quite... It's
that moment.
It is. And who did you study with first?
I studied with Judy Collier. She's an organist in the Encinitas region.
Yeah.
And so I showed up, had never touched an organ before, and so I fumbled my way through the Toccata in D minor of Bach. And so she said, well, we never start with Bach, but we start with something a little more imaginable at first, but looks like you can do it, so let's let's go. And then I studied with Chris Cook in the San Diego area, who was a great mentor, and he helped me first with improvisation.
Yes.
He's a great teacher of improvisation. I don't think that's known around here, but he's very good at that. And then with repertoire, and then to my current teacher, Cherry Rhodes.
Yes.
Who I've been studying with since I was 15.
Right.
And she's...
She's
one of the biggest influences of my life, along with my parents. You know, she's that kind of person.
She's great. I remember hearing her years ago at the Royal Festival Hall, and I remember she walked on stage, and it was such a presence. She looked fantastic. She played. She means
business.
Talk
about connecting with an audience.
Yeah.
I mean,
So you're at Thornton School of Music?
Yeah.
Right. So I know you're obviously studying organ. What else do you study there?
Well, so I'm a double major with organ and with composition.
Oh. Yeah.
And so I think, you know, I'm the first student in the history of USC, as far as they know, as far as I know, to do that combination of these two programs, composition and organ.
So are they, like, equal?
Equal in workload.
Yeah. They're, right.
I mean, depending on the week.
Yeah.
But, I mean, organ is... It's not really a workload so much as a lifestyle, you know?
Yeah.
I remember the first week thinking, wow, you know, I don't really have that much work here. Oh, but practicing counts as work, so okay. I guess I've learned.
So you do composition and organ. Mm-hmm. What else do you do? Like history of music and all that stuff?
Well, those are all the required courses in any music major. You have music history, music theory, analysis.
Right.
And probably the most influential class of all time for me, counterpoint.
Yeah.
And so I... never studied it before going to USC, even though I'd composed for several years, and I was experiencing a kind of artistic empty period where I just couldn't get my ideas on paper, and I think, what's going on with composition? I was really stuck. And you know, when you write a piece and people sort of like it, it gets like maybe 2 views on YouTube, and you think, oh boy, I'd better do something to match that, you know.
2 views.
And then, before you take it off after being embarrassed 2 weeks later, and then you think, you know, I gotta do something better than that. And then it's your, my mom calls it the not enough monster.
The what, sir?
The not enough monster. You know, it's never enough. And of course, when you're writing music, it's never enough, because you can't write a full orchestral score like that. You know, it takes a lot of thought. And actually, before I write a piece of music, I like to have about a month before I even write anything, or any final material at least, where I just think about it.
Yeah?
Yeah. Even when I'm practicing, say I'm practicing front, I'm thinking, oh, that's a nice turn, and a nice way to use impoggiatura or something like that. Keep thinking about that.
Mm.
But what I was saying was, you know, I'm the first student at the school to do these two majors. I mean, double majoring is common there with biology and piano, for example, or things like that. But organ and composition, to me, they're the same thing. And I'm sure you'd agree as well, with as being a composer as you are, that when you play music, it's like composing with other people's notes.
Yeah.
To me, you know?
You can still say a good melody in C major. I mean, there's still a lot there to be said.
There's still a lot there to be said, yeah. And then in B triple sharp minor.
Yeah, with, right. You know, so what's a typical day? When you're studying at college, what do you do? When you get up and you fall on the organ?
Get up, I go to class.
Yeah.
Or usually I have breakfast, and I'm half awake having breakfast. The left hand
is on the organ?
Not on the organ. No. That's not allowed. And having breakfast with the left hand and studying a Mahler symphony with the right. But sort of, you know, there's only so much you can do in 15 minutes before going to class. So I figure, well, I better look at this measure and see. Well, there's in Mahler, there's a lot in a measure. So, and then in class, well, I took Morten Lauritsen's freshman theory class.
Mm-hmm.
Now, believe it or not, I had no idea who he was before going there. Mm-hmm. And I figured out on the first day of class that he's the most performed American choral composer.
Mm-hmm.
And that class gave me a lot of the, you know, when you compose, as you know, you have this sense of, this is a dissonance, and you sort of feel it in here, and then when you resolve it, it's almost a physical feeling.
Yeah.
And I had this notion first in that class, and where I didn't resolve an appoggiatura on the first day the way it should have resolved. I heard a lot about it from this expert teacher.
Yeah.
And so, well, a typical day, and then, you know, there's class, and there's looking at trees and eating lunch and thinking, wow, this is a cool place, and then practicing, obviously.
Mm.
And it really depends on the day and what I have, what kind of assignments. I balance it if I'm preparing a concert. It'll also greatly affect how I balance practice time.
Yeah.
If I'm not playing a concert, like for example, after playing this concert here at Spreckles, now I want to learn all the Opus 10 Chopin etudes.
Yes.
But it's not something I want to play on an organ concert.
No.
But it's a different kind of practicing that's more for me.
Yes.
And that I can gauge differently with homework and how I... So really, there's no typical day. Each day is very different.
That's probably what's nice about it, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean...
Yeah, it's always an adventure.
So you've played... Already, you've played lots of organs. I mean, do you have any favorite organs?
Favorite organs? Well, you know, they're all so different. Yeah. It's like saying favorite composers. You mean...
Yeah.
Yeah, I played at Saint Eustache, and I gotta say that was an amazing experience. First of all, because I got to work with Jean Guillou,
yeah,
a great hero of mine, in all respects. And then the organ there, I felt it. Whatever idea I had in my mind, I could get it on that organ.
Yeah.
And but then again, you know, there's nothing like playing in a summer park,
yes,
like we play here for 3,000 people. Who are really into it and who really love that. And this organ has, here at Spreckles, has so much character.
It does, doesn't it?
And
it's got more character since I've been here. It's incredible how they've added to the instrument, but they've added the right things, not just added stuff.
It's like with an old guitar, you know, it gains character every year.
Yeah. Yes.
And I feel like this is a monument in that way. And it's interesting with an organ. I feel it's the most paradoxical instrument.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, it can go the loudest and softest and the lowest and highest of any instrument. But that's a given. But then you think...
The musical aspects of that.
Yeah, the musical aspect. I mean, when an organ builder builds it, it's supposed to be a great work of art.
Yes.
But when we sit down and play it, it has to be this responsive machine.
Yeah.
It's nothing more than a machine when we play it.
Right.
Yet for this organ builder, it's a great work of art.
Yeah.
And so there's so much. It's like the International Space Station. There's so much going into it. Whose is it?
Yeah.
We don't know, but that's I feel like why I can't pick your favorite organ.
That's a good answer to that one.
Because it's a great work of art. It's a machine.
Yeah.
And depending on the quality, sometimes it's more than one than more the other. But there's always a sweet balance. I think if I could pick three organs that I've picked so far, played so far, it'd be Saint Eustache, Spreckles, and Wanamaker's.
Yeah, that's great. I'm glad we're in there.
Yeah. No, but it's true. Where else?
Yeah, I know. It is pretty neat. So when you write a composition and you, I mean, how do you approach it? Say you're going to write something for piano or whatever. How do you go? You say you think about it for a month.
Yeah.
I mean,
at least.
Right. And do you say tackle it every day, or do you just do it when you're inspired? How does it work for you?
Well, if I did it when I was inspired, I would never write anything. So.
When do you let go of it? I mean, when do you know it's done?
Oh, when I'm tired of working on it.
Really?
Yeah, well, in a way, it's never done.
Yeah.
You know, these great Boulez masterpieces, when is he going to come out with another version of it?
Yeah.
These great Mahler symphonies, this Fifth Symphony, was never done. It was never finished.
Yeah.
Because he kept revising and he said, oh my God, I was a middle schooler when I wrote this, you know. how do I approach it? Well, it's different with every piece. If there was one way to approach it, I would write a lot more music because I would be more informed for the next piece.
Do you use the old-fashioned way of writing on manuscript paper?
Oh, yeah, always.
And then you use finale, do you?
I use Sibelius, but for me, Sibelius is the final step to get the piece played.
Right.
And I only do Sibelius so I can make parts for my players, obviously.
Right.
But for me, when I write music, especially when I write counterpoint, and all my music is somehow contrapuntal, and I think all music is somehow contrapuntal, even one line of music, if we've studied, at least when I've studied counterpoint a lot, I feel like when I write one line of music, I know, I have the conscience of horizontal and vertical, which is what counterpoint is. It's more of a conscience than a real, physical skill, but to me, with the, writing with manuscript paper, that's how I can feel inside the music.
That's interesting.
Whereas with Sibelius, to me, it's like a museum piece. There's a glass in front of it, quite literally.
That's pretty neat, yeah.
And to write
and
one note...
And it slows you down, doesn't it? I mean, yeah.
Try writing one note in Sibelius. Yeah. Well, you have to name the file, and you have to...
Yeah, I know.
Wrong octave.
I know. What do you think you're going to end? I mean, you've already achieved so much. You're a fantastic performer.
Thank you.
Obviously a fantastic composer. What do you see yourself doing in 5 years' time?
5 years'
time? 10 years' time. I mean, what do you want to do?
I want to revolutionize the organ. And I'm very serious about that, because to me, the organ as a musical instrument, especially as an instrument viewed by composers, and I see this being in the composition department at USC, which is a fantastic department, the organ is where the piano was when Beethoven finished the Appassionata Sonata. Mm-hmm. A lot of great music has been written for it, but so much of it is still inspired by Bach and how Bach treated the organ. Mm. And Bach was an absolute genius, and perhaps he created organ technique in the way that Chopin created the piano technique, mm-hmm. but there's so much more we can do with the organ. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of ideas that I have with organ building, mm-hmm. Console arrangements and mm-hmm. techniques. Like, say we could have a crescendo pedal that would affect only the divisions that we want it to affect. Mm-hmm. Imagine how much more symphonic an organ could be with that one little trick.
Yeah.
And so tricks like that, but also in composition, what Liszt sat down and did with the piano,
yeah,
basically rethinking what the piano can do and saying, the piano, Liszt said, it's like an orchestra. There's as much subtlety that I can get from an Erard piano from Paris than an orchestra. The only thing I can't do is effects of mass. You know, like in Berlioz, you have 120 string players all going collegno and all going completely crazy. Can't do that with, can't get that effect with the piano, but on the organ you can.
You can. Right.
And we have so much color and so much possibility. To my composer friends who say, well, how do we do colors on the organ? And how many colors are there? Well, think about it this way. I tell them, how many ranks do we have here? 73, is it?
That's about 75 now.
75, yeah. Mm-hmm. There's 61 pipes, more or less, per rank. 61 times 73, that's...
Yeah, plus all the...
That's a lot of pipes. And also every possible...
And then there's the couplers and all that business. And
yeah, that's...
It's 10 plus.
The percussion, the car horn.
Yeah.
But that, think of every possible combination of 73.
I know.
That's in the billions. That's,
it is. It is.
And that's the amount of colors we have on this one. So
what, when you leave college and stuff, do you want to go on a concert platform for a couple of years?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Well, obviously you're there now, I mean.
I would love to play as many concerts as I can and to go, mm-hmm. and to go on tour, not only with the great pieces of the repertoire, but also with new music, mm-hmm. and with my own compositions and with compositions of those around me.
Yeah.
And because I feel like there's so much, like I said, to be said with the organ.
Yeah.
With the great repertoire and with new music and with transcriptions, and I just love traveling and playing.
Yeah, that's part of it, isn't it? It's just
absolutely
it's not just
that.
The organ; it's the culture.
Oh, yeah.
And you get that culture, which somehow is in part of the organ too. You know what I mean? It's just each building has a different smell.
And
the people around it, then you get to the different restaurants and it tastes food, and it's just
everything. The best part, You're talking to the French person here. Well, and also it's interesting because if I make registrations thinking to myself in French, and it sounds silly, but then my registration sounds different than if I think to myself in American English.
Well, that makes sense.
And I'm sure you find that with British English and American English. And then when you're in a country, I mean, I can only imagine going to, I don't know, to Germany and hearing the German language and then doing these registrations on this very German organ that sounds...
Very German.
Very German. And and it's just a completely different experience. And that's what we have with the organ. There are organists whom I respect enormously who say that, well, the great downside of the organ is that we can't get to know it when we play it because... We're on different organs all the time. A pianist, Christian Zimmermann, travels with his piano, but we can't travel with the organ. But I think that's so interesting. It's like a conductor with an orchestra.
Mm.
Bernstein has a week with the Vienna Phil to put together a Mahler symphony, and that's as interesting as the concert.
Right, you know? When you go to a different venue and you go to a different country and you play the organs,
you come every time I come back here, I approach this organ differently.
Oh, yeah.
Because you've brought in different culture. I mean, like you're going to hear Olivia Latree play this organ. You're going to hear it in a very French way.
Yeah.
And every artist makes this instrument sound very different.
Yeah.
And that is really interesting to me. Yeah. Yeah.
Because with pianists, even if we travel with a piano,
we can make it sound different
every time.
Yeah, well, the room's going to be different.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you take the same organ, you know, specification, different buildings, you got two different organs.
Yeah.
I mean, they're very different.
Well, and oh no, the swell trumpet isn't as loud as I thought it was. Well, better rethink all this manual
absolutely.
Stuff. Absolutely. Better rethink finger these thumbing downs. You
yeah.
know, that's the adventure.
Oh, yeah, and that's part yeah. of the fun. I mean, it takes days to register, as you know, but if you didn't enjoy it, you're in the wrong job. Because it's tiring if you sit there and you have to register a whole program and you just think, oh, God. But if you really enjoy it.
You know.
And I hate getting to venues where I'm like, you know, I want to be able to rehearse, and I know you do, and it's and I get kind of annoyed with artists who come in here and they don't give themselves enough time. Mm-hmm. And yet they're under stress, and you can feel it sometimes in their performance because they don't know the organ. And then it's, what's the joy in playing, making music?
Yeah. And this is such a particular kind of organ we have here. It doesn't sound like anything in the world.
I mean, if we enjoy it, then we get it across in our music, I think.
Well, and it's with all music. I feel like, how can you... You know, when I think I was 8, I was taking guitar lessons, and I was pretty advanced for an 8-year-old kid. And I decided I didn't want to do it anymore, so I stopped for maybe 3 months. And so my mom very wisely said, okay, sure.
Yeah.
And the moms that she hangs out with sometimes would tell her, you let him stop music?
Yeah.
So my mom would say, but you can't force art onto someone.
No, of course, you're absolutely right.
The passion has to be there.
Yeah, if it's not there.
And when you play, when great artists play, there's passion.
Yeah.
And that's why Horowitz can play.
We don't get tired of our work.
No.
Well, yeah, we get sometimes
work,
tired of the
you know.
People around us. But you never get tired of the music.
No.
You know, the music keeps you going. So what do you do for fun? I mean, sorry, not fun. What do you do for hobbies? I mean, besides music, what else do you do?
Well, besides music, well, I love hiking.
Right.
And I love...
that's good.
I was actually just in Santa Cruz looking at the trees, the big redwoods.
Oh, that's pretty.
And so you're sitting there looking at a...
Something that's like makes you feel really small.
Yeah,
isn't it?
And this tree is 5 meters wide and it's 100 meters tall.
So that's a really old tree, isn't it?
It's a 2,500-year-old tree.
Golly.
And it was here when some trees in that grove were here before the Romans ever were a thing.
Yeah, and it's us worrying about registrations here.
Yeah, and you know that's what I thought when I was playing at Wanamaker's. I played the Guillou transcription with Prokofiev Toccata there.
Yes.
So, you know, I started very, very softly, and it sounded like the whole thing was coming up, but that's a big redwood forest, that organ, you know?
That's a nice description.
And that's what Guillou told me, the organ is, it's a forest.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what I love, this connection. And here in Balboa Park, again, this connection with nature.
Yes.
Where else can you play Liszt and hear birds?
I know.
Because Liszt was the first composer, as far as I know, well, not the first, but the first to really do it seriously in a whole piece, to include birds, quite literally as inspiration, but also as
he predated Messiaen.
As a color,
right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, right.
Well, Liszt predated everyone.
Yeah.
If you think about it.
Incredible guy.
And at the end of his life, he was saying, "Oh, I haven't been creative enough," and he was depressed and turned to alcohol.
A lot of musicians, I think it's hard that we do criticize our work. It's very hard to listen to your own work.
Oh yeah.
I mean, but in a way, that's a good thing, because there's a point you have to let it go.
Yeah.
You have to move on to something else, otherwise you'd never get past.
Oh yeah.
The first page.
Like you were saying, how do you know when it's done, the piece?
Sometimes you just know you got to let go.
Yeah.
Move on.
Yeah, that's tough.
Thomas, it has been great chatting with you.
Thank you.
And there's gonna be many more great concerts, I know that.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And thank you to you for your great work here.
Thank you.
That's stunning.
Thank you.
Woo!